Hello, I wanted to talk today about the world of work, specifically whether we should be looking at doing less work rather than more. At the moment, we work hard all the time and we have hardly any time for our lives, those of us who have jobs, of course. And we count ourselves as the lucky ones because we need jobs to get money, and we need money to pay the bills. People who rely on benefits have a much higher chance of ending up in considerable debt over time because benefits are A, unreliable, and B, insufficient, actually. They're calculated according to some inscrutable formula that is always out of date, and is based on the idea, really, that people who are not working are scroungers, which is not always true, after all. Although, at the moment in Britain, there is apparently something over 1.1 million more jobs available than there are actual people to take them up at the moment. So roll on the immigration, and yet there are still plenty of unemployed people. Unemployment hovers around a few percent officially, but is probably unofficially more like 10 to 12%, especially when you count the people who are underemployed, who actually want full-time jobs but have part-time jobs, and people who simply can't get a job because they're not what employers are looking for. They don't present well or whatever it is. They don't have years of experience or training or something. Nevertheless, for most people, that means most working people, I suppose, not really most people. Life is too hectic. Our lives are very busy compared with how they used to be, even though in the old days, very old days, people worked longer hours. We seem to have more to do. And obviously, I'm not talking about the days when people were working 60 hours a week or 80 hours a week back in the early days of the Industrial Revolution. That was way too much. Or back in the third world, people still do work these hours and they have no life outside work. I mean, many of them actually sleep in the factory because they haven't got time to go home or anything. Now, I'm talking about here in the West, the UK particularly, because that's where I live, but I think it's the same throughout the Western world, largely. So, what am I complaining about exactly? It's kind of, do we have wasted lives, really? It's a matter of going to work for maybe 8 hours. Give my job as an example. Say I work for 8 hours plus there's an hour for lunch. That's 9 hours. Let's say it takes me an hour each way to travel. That's 11 hours used up out of every weekday. I have to eat something in the morning before work. I have to eat something after work. That's maybe 12 to 13 hours used up, somewhere like that. And really, if I were to fit any other stuff in, I'm likely to have to go to bed late. So there's a tendency by the end of the week to be short of sleep. And I know some, a lot of people go out as well, because that's their way of getting over it. So sleep is the first casualty, and it's known scientifically that a 5% shortage of sleep results in a 20% shortage of intellectual ability, basically. So the long hours are counterproductive even for many employers, because their employees are too tired to really concentrate properly on the job, and they do a poor quality job, actually. There is a movement to reduce the working week to 21 hours. That is not going to happen anytime soon, obviously. but it needs to be considered. I mean, I couldn't afford to work part-time, 21 hours, say, unless my wages were still the same. And of course they wouldn't be, they'd be half what they are. Therefore I wouldn't be able to afford the rent and all the rest of it. And this is, I'm sure, true for most people. If you're in the position to be able to work part-time and afford it, and maybe save some surplus as well, not just exist, I would think you're in an enviable position. And yet, somebody new started at my place doing part-time work. She was there for 2 days. She previously had a full-time job, but she came here to do part-time work. After 2 days, she complained that she didn't know what to do with her time when she got home. And so she quit. She wants longer hours. My mind boggles at that, because I would have so much to do. Even just sleeping and staring at the ceiling. I mean, it's something. You know, you can relax, you can meditate, you can do a project, you can go for a walk. There's so much you can do. You can read a book. But some people don't really have the imagination. And maybe they're better off in work. I don't know. I think if it was the same for everybody, one would develop a social life around this extra time. In fact, there are lots of things. Let me look at my notes. I mean, working such long hours actually prevents us from doing lots of things. We develop certain skills in work related to the job which we wouldn't develop otherwise. So that's an advantage, if you like, of work. You study various subjects up to quite a high level, which you wouldn't need to do otherwise. And a good education can be good, although if it's strictly job-related, it's questionable whether it counts as good education. But it's an education. But it does, by the same token, it prevents you developing skills for yourself, about things you are actually interested in, non-work skills. I mean, after 11 or so hours of my day are used up, I don't want to be going out and doing sports or anything else. I'm too tired, and I've really got an hour or so to do something at home before I have to go to bed, effectively. It stops people pursuing other interests. They get home, they're tired, all they can do is you know, flop down in front of the boob tube, the TV, and watch some boring stuff, and go to bed, because they're too tired to do much else. I've already mentioned the shortage of sleep. There's also a problem of shortage of daylight and sunshine. Certain diseases are more prevalent in the northern and extreme southern latitudes, and it relates, presumably, to the shortage of sunshine. In the winter, it's dark when I leave home to go to work, and it's dark when I leave work to come home. If I didn't make it my habit to get out of the office at lunchtime for an hour every day, I would get almost no sunshine in the winter. another thing you lose if you're working long hours is family time. How many people, men especially, have missed their children's childhoods, basically, by being out of the house at work all day? The kids are asleep by the time they get home, you know. Maybe they see them at the weekend for a bit. basically, we could have much richer lives outside work if we had fewer hours to work. We could work on, for those who are interested, there's personal growth and development, there's meditation, enlightenment, yoga, exercise, sport, as I mentioned. I can remember about 12 years or so ago, 2004 to 2006, something like that, there was a big recession and I was unemployed for a while. And I was able to get fit. I haven't been able to maintain it since. I was quite fit, exercising quite a lot. I had the time. And so I did it. You can only sit around doing nothing for so long, okay? And then you start to get constructive. At least that's me, anyway. I'm very lazy, but only up to a point. It also prevents people getting involved in their local communities. The pub is a community section in Britain. This is people go there and they chat and drink and so on, and the alcohol lubricates all that. In other cultures, people don't do that so much, but men and women drink quite commonly in Britain. I'm not into it myself, but it's probably 80% of the population. On a Friday night, when I'm going home from work, you can hear voices echoing all around you in London. It's really strange. And you see there's a pub nearby and there are crowds, not just in the pub, but out, spilling out onto the streets as well. Because there's so many people going there for a Friday night drink and a chat. Or usually a shout, because it's so loud you can't hear anything. Unless you shout. It stops people getting involved in charity work. Most of the charity volunteers are unemployed people or housewives who are technically unemployed but busy enough, you know. It stops you meeting friends and making friends even, in many cases. You meet colleagues at work, but it's not usually the same. Sometimes it is. You can make actual friends too, but commonly you don't. And maybe a key one for the conspiracy theorists is it stops people getting involved in politics. Because there's no time. You're tired. You watch the TV, you let it brainwash you, you believe everything the news tells you. You assume it isn't slanted. And when they want to go to war, you say, oh yes, they've done us wrong, let's go. It's terribly uncritical. It's interesting, though, with the latest Brexit vote this year and the Donald Trump vote this year, how the brainwashing appears to be weakening. Although I suspect Donald Trump is a trick candidate and he's now talking the same old talk as every other president for the last 20 years or so, actually. And even to the point of appointing Goldman Sachs financial advisors to his cabinet, if I can call it that, his inner advisors. After slagging Goldman Sachs off during the campaign, he's now appointing their people, as other presidents have done, all the time. So we were lied to, I think. Of course, it's all very well saying we could do with shorter hours, but how would that happen? Well, we'd probably have to change our priorities a bit. One issue, of course, is governments concentrate very hard on GDP, gross domestic product, the economic output of the country, because at bottom, we have to keep up with our military competitors. We have to be able to pay for our defences. I think Europe and stuff pay, you know, only a couple of percent of our GDP towards military. America pays a lot more. Russia, I'm sure, pays a lot more. But as jobs become more automated, and even the military can become more automated, we're going to get to a situation where maybe we can start looking realistically at well-being rather than GDP. Because clearly governments concentrate on economic output, but economic output does not equal happiness. And it's a fact that people in the West are, on average, not particularly happy. Considering our apparent financial well-being compared with the rest of the world, it's surprising. But we're quite high on scales of depression and stuff like that. So I'm sure if I were working in the Philippines in some factory 18 hours a day or something, I would not be very happy about that either. I don't know how people manage it. Maybe I'll discuss those issues in another video, but the luxury products that pepper our shelves are made in places like that, because it's cheap. And it's up to us as consumers really not to buy them, but of course people are people, and pretty dumb on the whole, and we're just mugs basically. We just buy all this junk that we don't need. And maybe those people are better off than they were before anyway. At least they're making some money. This is the argument that is put forward. And over time, their standard of living maybe will improve. We went through the exact same thing in the 18th and 19th centuries in the West, in fact. At first, competition was vicious, and it forced every manufacturer down to the lowest possible level of welfare, because if they didn't do it and their competitors did, they would lose out and be bankrupt. And it's like that in the third world at the moment. Legislation gradually is brought in, very slowly. However, we keep those countries in debt. Our World Bank and institutions like that loan them money and force them to chop down their forests to pay us back, basically. You can watch John Pilger's movies about the Philippines and Thailand and places like that, if you want. They're on his channel. They're on YouTube as well sometimes. And it's hard to know whether capitalism is being a real benefit to those people or not. It doesn't look like it to us. But are they better off for having some sort of jobs? Bad jobs, it seems to me. Foxconn over there has decided to convert its factories to robots after so many people in their factories commit suicide. They had to put netting up around the roofs to stop people jumping off. They're not automating them strictly because of this. It's just efficiency. It's cheaper even than a Thailand worker, isn't it, to have some robots, you know, and just a few people running the factories. They're going to be replacing 60,000 jobs over the next few years. What are those people going to do? There's no proper welfare in those countries. And what are we going to do in the West when robots take over? Probably we will get welfare, unless we're wiped out with a little nuclear war or something, just to get rid of us. I don't know. What will be. This overproduction that we have, when you look at the shops, I think there was a study done of some Tesco supermarkets. And they found they had something like 188 different varieties of shampoo on the shelves. It seems a bit over the top. I mean, choice is great. It's really good to have this choice, and they still don't necessarily have the ones I would really prefer. saying they have about, I don't know, 40 or 50 different types of toothpaste there. And in fact, they discontinued the ones that I preferred, typically. The choice is good on the one hand, and the variety is good on the one hand. But on the other hand, it seems a bit over the top. And on the third hand, if you have a third hand, most of these products are actually made, especially on the cosmetics and household goods sections, by just two big corporations, Unilever and Procter & Gamble. So it's not even real competition, actually. It's just brands in this sort of fantasy world. Each brand has their own little team competing. It's kind of efficient for the company, for the corporation. But whether it represents real competition for the consumer, I rather doubt. I mean, they got big because they were good. But small companies, how do they start up without massive capital? Because they would need to be able to produce a lot to be able to get into the supermarkets in the first place. Because these big chains, of course, they have hundreds and hundreds of stores all over the country and even all over the world in some cases. So you have to be able to produce immediately large, large quantities of the goods very cheaply because, of course, the stores put on sales all the time, and because they're big, they also make the sales at the vendors, the production producers, that's the word, expense. They don't take the hit themselves. So you have to have at least 100% margin as a producer, otherwise you can't do that. But this overproduction, if it is overproduction, it's arguable. Choice and competition, where they really exist, are good. Isn't the main issue, if you like, I have with capitalism. It's pushing the boat out a bit far. And it could be reined in a bit, perhaps. But for me, the big problem is built-in obsolescence. Companies compete, and yet that doesn't stop them producing shoddy goods. You'd think it would, but it doesn't. Goods are deliberately made to break after a period of time, so that you'll buy another one, or you'll buy the next model up. And this is clear if you look at, say, how the Soviet Union did it. It was a terrible state, obviously. I'm not advocating that form of dictatorial socialism at all. But when they produced goods, they made them to last 20, 30, 40, 50 years, because they knew that they did not in any way have the capacity to produce enough goods. Their production system was bad in terms of variety and choice, and even productivity and creativity. But when they made a product, they really made it solidly so it would not go wrong. And many products were actually sold with a box of spare parts to go with them so that you could repair them at home and they would last. It's not unusual in Russia today still to find items which were made 50 years ago still working. Whereas over here, for example, I bought a pair of mittens for my upcoming holiday in Norway. Okay, and I've worn them, trying them out in the winter here for 2 weeks. They're nice and warm. But I've had to do 4 repairs on them so far in 2 weeks because of threads coming undone and stuff like that. It's terrible. These things are made to last at best one season. It's perfectly possible to make gloves or mittens that last many years. It's absolutely... They're not a dud. I can assure you the products in general are like this. I mean, you know it yourself, I'm sure. And We get the same in other ways, like with telephones, where new, better systems are brought out, 2G, 3G, 4G, and so you get rid of your old phone because it's no longer tolerable, even though actually it still works. There are more functions on the newer ones, so you get rid of it. I mean, improvements in products is not quite the same as built-in obsolescence, but it's related. Upgrading. We upgrade Windows every 2 or 3 years, even though, from a user's point of view, it basically does exactly the same as the old one. They shuffle the menus about a bit to confuse you. They claim it's an improvement, and it hardly ever is. Maybe they don't have to do that. They could just change the back end and send you some upgrades as and when needed to handle newer hardware, which, again, we're improving the technology on the one hand, but on the other hand, my hard drives fail maybe every couple of years because of built-in obsolescence. Or is it that the technology just isn't capable of being good? I think it is capable. You can buy military-grade products which do last. Obviously, they're more expensive, but it can be done. And it's not a false economy, is it, to buy a more expensive item if it's going to last? Of course, in the case of hard drives, we need bigger and bigger, more and more capacity as well. So there's always the two sides of this argument. But overall, one of the biggest issues I have with capitalism is this built-in obsolescence. Upgrades are the other side of it. That's arguable and it's okay. But where a simple thing like a pair of gloves basically, or mittens, break down after literally a couple of weeks, it's ridiculous. And other products too. They'll come with a battery built in that you can't change, for example. Obviously, you can hack at it and do it if you really want to. Or they'll just be cheapo plastic which cracks or something after a while. It goes hard and brittle and breaks or something, you know, the sort of thing. This is sheer wastefulness, and it's destroying the Earth's resources and competition drives that. In fact, rather than preventing it, it drives it, because the companies need you to come back and buy more stuff. And there are so many products doing it that, I don't know about you, but I don't even remember which companies have sold me the shoddy goods so that I can avoid going back to them anymore. Sometimes I remember and I do avoid it, but other times I don't. But I go to another company and they're just as bad. There isn't real competition in that area, for the most part. It's hard to find quality products. Good quality products, that is. It may be that this is a symptom in part of the fact that we don't actually have capitalism. We actually have corporatism. These are giant corporations which rule the world. Little capitalist companies which would produce better goods, I'm sure, are crushed by regulations which are too expensive for them to comply with, and by the fact that they can't get into the big distribution networks anyway because they can't produce in the quantities required to grow or to get there. They have to get their capital in the first place from somewhere. You have to be rich to get rich. We probably need some system. We need to wind the system back somehow or work on a newer one which is fairer and less wasteful. I mean, the average citizen is not an out-and-out capitalist, the average human, if you like. Most people are pretty socialist. They want freedom, but they also want protection. They want welfare. But what we tend to have is welfare for the rich in the form of huge government contracts for them to make goods and huge capitalist inputs from wealthy sources. And then socialism, so it's kind of socialism for the rich and a capitalism for the poor. But the trouble is the poor people can't afford this kind of corporate capitalism. We're all poor and struggling, or nearly all. Very tough to know how the system can evolve to get around this, but I think it needs to. Maybe it will happen by way of technology making jobs obsolete that will force changes. Either they'll let people die off and starve, or more likely we'll get some sort of universal basic income introduced gradually. I'm going to make a video about that, probably. And I talked about how the governments measure GDP rather than overall welfare, and we are in competition with other countries. One advantage of being out of the EU means there's less pressure to shadow the euro with our interest rates, which will help our economy. We'll be able to compete with it properly. Britain was actually starting to do very well under Margaret Thatcher until Nigel Lawson, the Chancellor, decided to shadow the Deutschmark with interest rates and the German interest rates. It was a disastrous decision, and the big benefits that happened during the 80s were squandered, basically destroyed. What a waste. Anyway, we're out of it, or almost out of it now. The thing is about measuring GDP, yes, we have to keep up, especially militarily, with competition, especially as we are part of a seemingly a very warlike race, you know, the Anglo-West. Is that humans, yes, we are productive, but we're also ethical creatures, we're social creatures, we're creative creatures. Our system is an economic system. It's not a creative, social, ethical system. It has these elements a bit, but that is nowhere near where the emphasis is. There are ministers for some of these things, but it's the Chancellor who's the big one. The finance ministers, you know. So not only is our economy, or if you like, our system focused on the economy, but so are our lives. I've mentioned like 11 to 12 hours a day are used up. Remember also, people spend their time at home studying to make themselves more employable. There's this talk of constant upgrades to one's skills these days. So I come home hoping to rest, but no, I've got to study ITIL or some rubbish to get to the next level, or to get my next job somehow, if I ever need a next job. It's just never ending nowadays. And the economy, when talking about the economy and talking about people, it's not just government, it's the whole idea of our system. A person, a man especially, but more so women too these days, isn't really treated as respectable, if you like, if they are not a wage earner, if they don't at least have a job, and preferably a good job with a good career, which is supposed to progress, okay, to more and more wages. Basically, often for more and more work, sometimes for less, if you're lucky, if you can get it right. If you're, although feminism has come a long way, if you are a man and you don't have a good job, women do look down on you. I'm sure you will have noticed that. The feminist attitudes only count when they count in their favour. It seems. We're certainly not all the same. The man is still actually expected to be the main breadwinner. And it makes sense, because obviously a woman is going to be off work for children usually at some point, and somehow the family has to survive for a couple of years, maybe more. And sadly, the children then packed into some chronic kindergarten where they mix with the lowest common denominators, and all your good teaching of them is ruined by them meeting the worst kids in the block, right? And probably taught by some other commonest teachers in the block as well. This is one reason why society has to advance by bringing up the lowest more than by advancing the highest, because they drag everybody else down. That's another issue. And so education at school really focuses on employability, and yet it does it very badly. But students are taught irrelevant stuff that's kind of irrelevant to their lives, but it teaches them to be ready to sit at a bench all day doing clerical work or computer work in a drab, colourless environment. By the time we get to adulthood, we're kind of conditioned to this and feel it's normal. What's normal really probably would be walking about outdoors or sitting under trees and gossiping, but normal nowadays is sat at some very plain bench or table with a screen in front of you or something like that, or a production line going along and you're just doing some repetitive tasks. And it's funny that schools don't manage to teach people how to treat customers. After a decade at school, you still don't know really much about business or anything like that. And yet, they're supposedly teaching us these things, but they're not. They're teaching conformity. The bell rings every 90 minutes and you drop what you're doing because it's unimportant. And you go to the next thing, which is also usually boring. And so on. And over the years you learn, all of this is boring, I've just got to get through it. And that's how you do your jobs as well, isn't it? Mostly, those of us who are lucky enough to have a good job should appreciate it. But, I wanted to finish with a quote, but I haven't got it here. Let me just find it. Hold on a second. It's from Bertrand Russell, who was a philosopher favouring something better than this. Where is it? It's from his book In Praise of Idleness. 2004? Okay. Modern methods of production have given us the possibility of ease and security for all. We've chosen, instead, to have overwork for some and starvation for others. Hitherto, we have continued to be as energetic as we were before there were machines. In this, we have been foolish, but there's no reason to go on being foolish forever. So there you go. Okay.